So next question. In ends and means relationship, Gandhiji believes which of the following? So we have already seen means justify the ends, right? So means determine the end. Okay, that would be the correct answer here. Let us see the discussion. The theory of Satyagraha sees means and ends as inseparable. The means used to obtain an end are wrapped up in and attached to that end. Therefore, it is contradictory to try to use unjust means to obtain justice or to try to use violence to obtain peace. Okay, so whatever your means or the path you take to get to the goal, that is also very important. As Gandhiji wrote, they say means are after all means. I would say means are after all everything. As the means, so the end. Gandhiji rejected the idea that injustice should or even could be fought against by any means necessary. If you use violent, coercive, unjust means, whatever ends you produce will necessarily embed that injustice. Okay, so that was what Gandhiji thought. Next, Mahatma Gandhi's remark, a post-dated check on a crumbling bank is regarding the proposal of which of this? So let us see the story behind it, that is the Cripps, okay, mission or the Cripps proposal. Early in 1942, Stafford Cripps, a member of the war cabinet of Winston Churchill, was sent to make a definite offer to India on behalf of British government. The proposals gave a severe blow to Indian unity as the provinces could not opt to join the federation, and this tantamounted to acceptance of Pakistan in principle. Secondly, it was felt that interests of India, people of Indian states were ignored, as Indian states would be represented by the representatives nominated by the rulers. So no election, okay, no elected representative, but the kings, okay, whom they will nominate, those people will represent that area. No limit was set for actual grant of dominion status, since the very foundation of British Empire seemed to be uncertain at that moment of World War. The long-term offer of dominion status was, as Gandhiji remarked, a post-dated check on a failing bank. So what would be the condition of England after the war, no one knew. Okay, so that is why Gandhiji said this. Next, what was the reason for Gandhiji's support to decentralization of power? Okay, why did he support decentralization? These are your options. Let us have the discussion. So, Gandhiji's greatest contribution to social thought in this century is perhaps his insistence on decentralization of means of production, that is economic power. According to him, large-scale industrialism is at the base of centralization of political power in few hands. That is why he was in favor of cottage industries. Okay, not that he called for a boycott of large-scale industries, but his model was different from the Nehruvian model. Pandit Nehru was more influenced by the Soviet Russia at that time. Okay, and he had seen what heavy industries and large-scale industrialization can do, so he went in that direction. Okay, but Gandhiji's concept was a village-based economy. Okay, it is in the very nature of large-scale industries to centralize economic power in the hands of a few individuals. So under capitalism, this power comes to be concentrated in the hands of individual capitalists, and under socialism, it is abrogated by managers, technocrats and bureaucrats. Okay, so that was his thought. Which of the following, according to Mahatma Gandhi, is the strongest force in the world? These are the options, you see. That is basically non-violence of the brave. Okay, someone who is capable of by force doing something, but he will do it by consensus or some other peaceful method. Okay, according to Gandhiji, non-violence is not passive. Okay, so many people think non-violence, it is passive. It is active, creative, proactive and challenging. Gandhiji describes non-violence a force more powerful than all the weapons of world combined. Non-violence is the greatest and most active force in the world. Gandhiji wrote, it is mightier than the mightiest weapons of destruction devised by ingenuity of humanity. We are tapped into the spirit of non-violence. When we tap into the spirit of non-violence, it becomes contagious and can topple empires. According to Gandhiji, one should be brave and not a coward. He should present his views, suggestions and thoughts without being violent. One should fight a war with weapons of truth and non-violence. Okay, that is what he believed in. Next, which scripture was called his mother by Gandhiji? So that is, you know, that is the Bhagavad Gita, because already we have seen in that question, okay, the philosophy of dispassionate action, which we were talking about, right? So it is the Bhagavad Gita. Gandhiji called Gita his mother and his spiritual reference book. It has seemed contradictory to many that a scripture that affirms the duty to kill is the basis of non-violence. Okay, so it's basically, you know, what this says. Okay, a scripture that affirms the duty to kill. What it means basically is that when violence is necessary, okay, to protect righteousness or dharma, dharma is not religion here, okay, then, you know, violence is also as good as non-violence. Like, you know, generally we always give the example of the shloka that, ahimsa parma dharma, right? So that non-violence is the highest action or religion, whatever. But that is not the complete shloka. That is the first part of the shloka. Second part tells you that in the same way, in order to protect dharma, okay, as I told you, dharma means righteousness. If you have to take up weapons, okay, that is also as noble, right? So that is why this, Gita has made it very clear in that, right? Affirms the duty to kill is the basis of non-violence. Gandhiji explained that the story is not meant to be taken literally. Its meaning is that in order to reach self-actualization, one must kill what is dear, most dear to us, that is our personal attachments. Okay, so Gandhiji has interpreted it in that way, self-actualization. Okay, that is the highest achievement, okay, of a human being. You must have studied Maslow's, okay, hierarchy. Starting from basic, your physical needs and all those things, okay, to the highest part, that is self-actualization. If you don't reach self-actualization, a human being is never content. Okay. Next question. Mahatma Gandhi was profoundly influenced by the writing of which of these writers? Okay, that's quite straightforward. That is Tolstoy. Okay, when Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi started to practice in South Africa as a young barrister in 1890, he was confronted with glaring racial discrimination as well as various other injustices. It was then that he began to develop his Satyagraha philosophy of non-violence, through which he could later lead India to independence. Perhaps the most profound influence on Gandhi at this time was the ideas and the living example of Russian author Leo Tolstoy, who in the last year of his life became Gandhi's mentor on non-violence. This is also important. By directly influencing Mahatma Gandhi, which is idea, through his work, that is, the kingdom of God is within you, Tolstoy has had a huge influence on non-violent resistance movement to this day. What is Gandhi's definition of Ramarajya? Okay, so we can go through that. That is basically, if you translate into English, welfare state. In post-colonial India, Ramarajya as a concept was first mooted by Mahatma Gandhi. Gandhiji announced that Ramarajya would be brought once independence arrived. When he was asked about the ideal state, he talked about Ramarajya. By using the Ramarajya slogan, Gandhiji implied an ideal Rajya or welfare state where values of justice, equality, idealism, renunciation and sacrifice were practiced. On the subject of Ram Rajya, Gandhiji wrote on February 26, 1947, let no one commit the mistake of thinking that Ram Rajya means rule of Hindus, okay, which is even now some people misinterpreted, okay. So Gandhiji has made it very clear, Ram Rajya generally means a welfare state, okay. My Ram is another name for Khuda or God. I want Khuda Raj, which is same thing as the kingdom of God on earth. Obviously, this meant an ideal society where everybody follows a code of righteous living, lives content and happy, and meet their essential needs. Ram Rajya, according to many scholars, meant that the state, that is Rajya, was the sole legitimate power which imposes limits upon its exercise of power, either for the greater happiness of people or to evade a greater tyranny that could be caused by moral outrage or self-righteousness. Okay, so next question. According to Gandhiji, which of the following are the major means of satyagraha? Non-cooperation, strike, demonstration or civil disobedience? Okay, so which of these should be there in your answer out of these four? So Gandhiji's main tactics in this fight against British, what he called satyagraha, which means soul force or the power of truth. Gandhiji developed satyagraha as a practical extension of ahimsa and love. It meant standing firmly behind one's ideals but without hatred. Satyagraha took the form of civil disobedience and non-cooperation with evil. Civil disobedience involved breaking a specific law if it was believed to be unjust and then facing the consequences. The other element of satyagraha, non-cooperation with evil, consisted of pulling out all support for an unjust system such as the British rule in India. Okay, that is the satyagraha. Next question. Through which principle or device did Mahatma Gandhi strive to bring bridge economic inequalities? Let us see. This is a very important theory. Understand this concept. Trusteeship. Okay, like you see in many organizations, there are trustees. Means the welfare of the organization, okay, that has been trusted on them. Right. So basically, Mahatma Gandhi's concept was the rich have to be the trustees of the poor. Okay, those the haves have to be the trustee of the have-nots. Okay, whether it has worked properly, it would work properly if the haves or the rich, okay, they basically, you know, they are of a pure mind or they want the downtrodden to be uplifted. Okay, but if that is not the case, it will become even more, dangerous and more exploitative. Trusteeship is a socio-economic philosophy that was propounded by Mahatma Gandhi. It provides a means by which wealthy people would be the trustees of trusts that look after welfare of people in general. Many very good examples are there. You see, many of the trusts which are run by Tatas and other organizations, you'll find that they do lot of charity and lot of good work. Okay. This concept was condemned by socialists as being in favor of the landlords, feudal princes and capitalists. Okay, so it was not the socialists, okay, were not very happy with that, the left leaning people. Okay, next, Gandhiji opposed the communal award because he thought this would bring, these are the options, so obviously, and he took action against that also, okay, and that would have, according to Gandhiji, separated or destroyed the unity in the Hindu society. In August 1932, the then Prime Minister of Britain, Ramsay MacDonald, gave his award known as the Communal Award. According to it, separate representation was to be provided for Muslims, Sikhs, Indian Christians, Anglo-Indians, Europeans, Dalits, etc. The depressed classes were assigned a number of seats to be filled up by election from special constituencies in which voters belonged to depressed classes only could vote. Gandhiji strongly opposed the communal award on the ground that it would discriminate or disintegrate Hindu society, he began an indefinite hunger strike from September 20, 1932 to protest this award. Okay, that is, he did it in the Yerawada jail in Pune. And then, you know, there was a pact, the Pune Pact, okay, between Babasaheb Ambedkar and Gandhiji. Gandhi-Irwin Pact is associated with which of the following? So, I'll just make it a bit fast. The Gandhi-Irwin Pact was a political agreement signed by Mahatma Gandhi and the then Viceroy of India, Lord Irwin, on 5th March 1931, before the second roundtable conference in London. One of the proposed conditions for the conference was discontinuation of the civil disobedience movement by Indian National Congress. And you know, many what you can say that points were there which Gandhiji, you know, insisted that the British should do. One of them was a political prisoner should be released, okay, and most of them agreed. And there was a lot of representation, because at that time this case of Bhagat Singh, the trial of Bhagat Singh and the hanging, okay, of Bhagat Singh, Rajguru and Sukhdev, how to stop that? One section of the society wanted that. They also approached Gandhiji for that. But and even if you, you know, if you are especially preparing for civil services, UPSC, you must read some of the books which are not course books. Okay, one such book is The Trial of Bhagat Singh. It is written by one of the prominent lawyers and activists, A.G. Noorani. And in that book, he gives in detail what were the conditions and all. And Gandhiji also mentioned that, but very feebly. Had he been very strong that, okay, if you are not going to, you know, if you are not going to, you know, kind of leave them, or at least ensure that they are not hanged, I am not going to sign the pact. Okay, because at that time, Lord Irwin, he was like desperate. Okay, civil disobedience has to be stopped somehow, and only Gandhiji could do it. So, he could have done anything to get, okay, the pact signed. Okay, so, but then that is something which is debated by a lot of historians. Okay, why, you know, Gandhiji did not push it, right? That's a different matter. So, that is about certain, you know, other things which we can link with what we study. Next, Gandhi started the Dandi March from which place? Again, direct question. These questions are, I'll tell you, these are basically state PSC prelims and SSC level questions. Okay, maybe some points can be important for UPSC, but not mainly UPSC. Okay, this is not in the level of UPSC. The Salt March, also known as the Salt Satyagraha, began with Dandi March on March 12, 1930. It was a direct plan, action plan of tax resistance and non-violent protest against the British salt monopoly in colonial India, and triggered wider civil disobedience movement. Okay, so it was a direct action. What were the components? Tax resistance, non-violence protest against salt monopoly. Mahatma Gandhi led the Dandi March from his base Sabarmati Ashram near Ahmedabad to the sea coast near the village of Dandi. Next, the Gandhian economy was based on the principle of, already we have seen, that is the trusteeship principle. Okay, where the rich people have to be trustees of the poor, right? Trusteeship is a socio-economic philosophy that was propounded by Mahatma Gandhi. It provides a means by which the wealthy people would be the trustees of trusts that look after the welfare of the people in general. This concept was condemned by socialists as being in favor of landlords, feudal princes and capitalists. Okay. Next question. Where did Mahatma Gandhi first apply his technique of Satyagraha? That was in, okay, South Africa. In 1908, the Transvaal government promulgated the Asiatic Registration Act. What was this? So, that is in South Africa, okay, Transvaal government. Compelling registration of colonies Indian population. At a mass protest meeting held in Johannesburg on September 11 that year, Gandhiji adopted his methodology of Satyagraha, that is devotion to truth, or non-violent protest for the first time, calling on his fellow Indians to defy the new law and suffer the punishments for doing so, rather than resist to violent means. Which of the directive principles can be described as Gandhian in character? So we had seen some of the directive principles in a question earlier. So out of these, obviously, it is the village panchayats. Okay. A number of directive principles are entirely Indian and Gandhian in nature, like setting up of village panchayat and cottage industries. Okay. Prohibition, protection against cow slaughter, etc. Again, such provisions as compulsory primary education for children up to 14 years and securing improvement of public health and prohibition of intoxicating drinks and drugs are all reflections of the amalgamation of the Gandhian philosophy. Next question. Which of the following are the most important teachings of Gandhiji? Truth, nonviolence, religion or satyagraha? Okay. Most important. Truth, non-violence and satyagraha. Okay, religion obviously was a very integral part from the personal side, okay, of Gandhiji. He was a deeply religious person. Okay, but he did not bring that openly in the public discourse. Okay, although he said that religion and politics cannot be completely separated. These are not watertight compartments. Okay, you cannot separate these. I think one or two questions are there later on which deal with this. So, truth, nonviolence and satyagraha were the key principles of Gandhiji around which he wove the Indian national movement. The three essential of Gandhiji's nonviolent direct action were constructive programs, that is spiritual, educational, economic development, this is one, non-cooperation, strikes and boycott and civil disobedience, that is protest, marches, sit-ins and other demonstrations. Satyagraha is a particular philosophy and practice within the broader overall category generally known as non-violent resistance or civil resistance. Gandhiji believed Ahimsa to be a creative energy force encompassing all interactions leading one self to find Satya or the divine truth. Gandhiji was staunch supporter of which of the following? So obviously the cottage industries, okay. Staunch supporter means strong supporter. So he did not oppose large industries, okay, but then primarily it had to be village based economy, cottage industries, okay, but it's not that, you know, he was saying that no, there should be no large scale industry, heavy industry, etc. That he was not saying. Gandhiji believed that country can only prosper if we make our villages economically independent through cottage industries. This was the principle behind Khadi movement, behind Gandhiji's urging the Indians spin their own clothing rather than buy British goods. Spinning would create employment during the many annual idle months of millions of Indian peasants. He cherished the ideal of economic independence for village. He identified industrialization with materialism and felt it was a dehumanizing menace to human growth. His last words were to make our villages economically independent through cottage industries. Next question. Gandhiji's movement of boycotting the foreign goods aimed at which of the following? Obviously, that would promote our industries, okay, rather than bringing and using their clothes, foreign clothes. Gandhiji believed that country can only prosper if we make our villages economically independent through cottage industries. This was the principle behind Khadi movement, behind Gandhiji's urging that Indians spin their own clothing rather than buy British goods. Next question. After the Chauri Chaura incident, Gandhiji suspended which of the following movement? So it's a direct question. Okay. Chauri Chaura came in prominence in 1922 when its inhabitants wholeheartedly participated in the non-cooperation movement started by Gandhiji. However, in February 1922, a police chowki or police station was set on fire by angry mob of citizens, killing 23 policemen inside. On February 12, 1922, the Indian National Congress halted the non-cooperation movement on the national level as a direct result of the Chauri Chaura tragedy. Okay, so non-cooperation movement was halted. Next question. According to Mahatma Gandhi, which of the following is correct? Okay, so did he th- think that religion and politics should be completely different. No, religion and politics must go hand in hand. Okay, so it was not like a compartmentalization. Religion and politics will be watertight compartments. Okay, nothing like that. Religion was central to Gandhi's life, thoughts and work, and he regarded politics as applied religion. However, he was a lifelong opponent of communalism, that is, bashing politics on religion, basing the politics on religion. For him, the two things, the social reordering and the fight for political Swaraj, must go hand in hand. Okay, so he was not like, you know, many of the political thinkers think that no, religion, you know, should be completely different and politics should be completely different. Okay. What was the name of a newspaper edited by Gandhiji till 1933? You know that, that is Young India. Okay, it's a direct factual question. And in South Africa also he was editing one, that was the Indian Opinion. Okay, you'll see that later. Young India was brought out in English by Mahatma Gandhi from 1919 to 1932. Gandhiji wrote various quotations in this journal that inspired many. He used the Young India to spread his unique ideology and thoughts regarding independence. Next question. Mahatma Gandhi launched the civil disobedience movement in 1930 from which place? That already in one of the explanations we have done that. That is the Sabarmati Ashram. On March 12, 1930, Gandhiji and 78 Satyagrahis, many of them were scheduled caste, set on foot for the coastal village of Dandi in Gujarat, over 390 kilometers from their starting point at Sabarmati Ashram, marking the beginning of the civil disobedience movement. Next question. The first Satyagraha of Gandhiji for the cause of indigo farmers was observed in which place? Okay, that also is a direct question. That is in Champaran. The Satyagraha of Gandhiji for the cause of indigo farmers was observed at Champaran in Bihar in 1917. Okay, so the problem was that, you know, those people were earlier growing food crops there and it was subsistence farming, so not mainly for selling. So they used to, you know, live on that, whatever they used to grow. But when these British settlers, okay, and this plantation owners, you know, they took up land there, what they wanted, profit. Okay, because obviously they were not you know, interested in the food produce here, so they asked or they pressurized the people or the farmers or the workers to plant indigo. Indigo's problem was it was a cash crop, okay, mainly used in chemical dyes and all the commercial use. Okay, so these people got some money. Okay, that also was not, you know, very good money, but whatever, they got some money. But the problem was that with that money, now they had to buy their food. Okay, that was one thing. Second was, you know, it was basically kind of these British landholders, or you can say these British plantation owners, what they wanted basically was only the profit. Okay, and once you plant indigo, it also negatively affects the soil fertility. Okay, so people were, these farmers were not, you know, very happy. So, the Satyagraha for these people by Gandhiji started, okay, at Champaran in Bihar. And many books, many poems, revolutionary poems have been written on it. One of such books is Neel Darpan, okay, on the indigo movement. According to Gandhiji, the scope for class struggle and love for property can be reduced by which of the following? Decentralization, participatory democracy, separation of judiciary from executive, or trusteeship. So already we have seen that Gandhiji's principle was trusteeship. Okay. The proposal of trusteeship was put forward by Gandhiji. Next, who said about Mahatma Gandhi that he is a half-naked fakir? Adhananga fakir. Okay, that is what he called. So, you know who that person was. That was Winston Churchill. Okay. Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi was born on 2nd October 1869 at Porbandar in Kathiawar district of Gujarat. The former Prime Minister of Britain, Winston Churchill, 1940-45 and again 51-55, called Mahatma Gandhi half-naked fakir. In 1937, an educational conference endorsing Gandhi's proposals for basic education through the vernacular medium was held at which place? Very, very famous. It is associated with that also. That is Wardha. Okay, the Wardha conference, or the Wardha outcome, as you can say, or the Wardha resolution, as you can say. On July 31, 1937, Gandhiji had published an article in the Harijan. Based on his article, an All India National Educational Conference was held in October 22 and 23, 1937, which was called the Wardha Educational Conference. Next, Gandhiji's concept of trusteeship. Okay, what is it? What are the properties of that? Okay, so basically, if you see, first recognizes right of private ownership of property, nothing of that sort. Okay, it does not de-recognize, it does not recognize, right? It does not deal with that at all. Transform the capitalist society into egalitarian one. Okay, that is basically what he wanted. Okay, that was the main intention. Trusteeship principle advocated by Gandhiji provides a means of transforming the present capital order of society into a egalitarian one. Means wherever everything is equal and no discrimination in that sense. He envisages trusteeship as a post-capitalist arrangement which gives no quarter to capitalism but gives the present owning class a chance of reforming itself. That means, see, you also live happily and whatever gains you are making, that also should be used for the development of everyone. The Dandi March of Gandhiji is an example of, already we have discussed that, that is direct action. It was a direct action. The Salt March, which began with Dandi March on 12th March 1930, was an important part of Indian independence movement. It was a direct action campaign of tax resistance and non-violence protest against the British salt monopoly in colonial India. Mahatma Gandhi began his political activities in India first from which place? Dandi Kheda, Sabarmati or Champaran? Okay, that is in Champaran, right? Which we have already discussed. After Gandhiji returned to India from South Africa in January 1915, the Champaran Satyagraha, that is 1916, was his first major struggle. Gandhiji took up the cause of Champaran indigo cultivators against the European indigo planters under the Teen Khatia system. Okay, what is this Teen Khatia system? Okay, you find it out, right? Does it deal with number of crops they were planting or, okay, Teen Khatia system, right? It was Gandhiji's first major political work in India. Next question. Which of the following is not correct about Mahatma Gandhi? So, Gandhiji advocated complete separation of religion and politics. Already we have seen he did not, you know, ask for that. He said that that is not possible. And it is not required also. Gandhiji advocated freedom of conscience and tolerance for other religions, not the full separation of religion from culture and government. He advocated a religion infected version of secularism based on needs of tolerance and pluralism is a means of promoting harmonious coexistence of different religions in India. He did not advocate strict separation of religion and politics. The only AICC session Gandhiji presided was held at which place? So you know that is in Belgaum. Okay. Mahatma Gandhi presided over the Belgaum session of Indian National Congress in December 1924. That was the only session where he presided over by him. The session was historic as Swaraj Party returned to the Congress fold. Which of the following institutions was not founded by Mahatma Gandhi? So that you know, it is Vishwa Bharati, because that is famous university which was founded by Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore. Rest all of this what is written, that is by Gandhiji. Vishwa Bharati was founded by Rabindranath Tagore in 1921 with proceeds from prize money of Nobel Prize he received in 1913 for publication of his book of poems Gitanjali. Until India's independence, it was a college. After independence in 1951, the institution was given the status of an university and was renamed Vishwa Bharati University. Which one of the following papers was edited by Gandhiji in South Africa? I was just telling you, that is the Indian Opinion. Okay, in South Africa, right? The Indian Opinion was a newspaper established by Indian leader Mahatma Gandhi in South Africa in 1903. The publication was an important tool for political movement led by Gandhi and National Indian Congress to fight racial discrimination and win civil rights for Indian immigrant community in South Africa. Next question. Which title given by British government to Mahatma Gandhi was surrendered after or during the non-cooperation movement? So he was given the title of Kesar e Hind. Okay, he surrendered that. Gandhiji was awarded Kesar e Hind in 1915 by Lord Harding, okay, of Penshurst for his contribution to ambulance service in South Africa. Okay, so remember that why it was given, Kesar e Hind. He returned the medal in 1920 as a part of national campaign protesting the Jallianwala Bagh massacre and in support of the Khilafat movement. Okay, because of these two reasons. Gandhiji's Satyagraha meant an attachment to the following two elements. Which of those? So, that is obviously, you know that, truth and non-violence. To Gandhiji, Satyagraha meant attachment to truth and therefore truth force or love force. It was a particular form of non-violent resistance or civil resistance. It was critical to Gandhiji's understanding of and faith in non-violence and went far beyond mere passive resistance. So, it was much more than passive resistance. What did Gandhiji meant by Sarvodaya? Okay. So, everyone's Uday in that sense. Okay. Rising of everyone. Right. Sarvodaya is a Sanskrit term meaning universal uplift or progress to all. The term was used by Gandhiji as the title of his 1908 translation of John Ruskin's tract on political economy. Unto this last and so remember that. And Gandhiji came to use the term for the ideal of his own political philosophy. In the Gandhian philosophy, Sarvodaya is true panacea for all types of social or political problems experienced by Indian society. It represents the ideal society order by bringing about a countrywide decentralization of both political and economic power and providing opportunity for the all-round development of individual and the society. That is what Sarvodaya is. Okay. In short, Sarvodaya envisaged a new humanistic, simple, non-violent and decentralized socialist society with man at its center. Okay, man, not machine or money. Right. So, this is the 50 questions we have discussed. Similarly, we will be having the tests. For the ranks and all, you can give those who want to give or the test. See, these tests which are in Telegram, they are always accessible. Okay, it's not that, you know, if you are seeing this video after 3 months also, still you can go to Telegram to the channel Arohan Classes. Okay, and there you can still give the test. Okay, you just have to search there, search the name of the quiz on Gandhiji or something, then you'll get the quiz. You can, okay, give the test, right? So, thank you all. We'll end here. Any doubts, you can WhatsApp me, right? Thank you.